In this video, I want to talk about two things. The first thing I'm going to talk about extraterrestrials, aircraft, how it's appearing in the news, some filmmakers that have really good information, interviews, footage, and so on the topic. And then I'm going to talk about a document related to astral projection. It was a document that was released through, I believe, the Freedom of Information Act. And it is on the CIA website. So if you go to the website of the CIA, they have a lot of documents that they've released. And this is one of them. And it talks about astral projection and the research that was done. They started investigating. And so I'll talk about that after I talk about the UFO topic. So it's going to be those two topics. Well, there's some UFO information that's coming out in the news that I'm noticing. Some videos, I think one from 2004 that was released, and the Pentagon commented on it. And it's showing up recently on some large news sites like CNN, BBC, and so on. A pilot was also interviewed, one of the pilots, and it's interesting how it's being talked about, you know, in the news. And I think in history, when we think about thousands of years ago, there are reports of beings that are in the sky, whether they're in chariots or ships or however it is that they're described, and they're in the sky and they come down and they seem like humans, like humanoid. And they have things to do with us. And this is, you know, people can have their opinions, but it's mentioned in the Bible. Crafts, chariots are described, and they're described as angels and demons, and they have these names for them, and there are some descriptions as well of what happens and what they do. And then in Sanskrit, which is thousands of years older, I don't know the exact dates of the writings of when Vimanas are mentioned, but Vimanas are mentioned. So throughout history, also with indigenous spirituality, a lot of times, eventually, as you go in and study, you see that they will mention the star people. So there's these references all through history about beings that have craft, and they are in the sky. So, and the idea is that they aren't human. They're kind of like human. So there's that. And then we've had this modern history kind of thing going on, Western civilization, modern thinking in certain kinds of ways. And there's been a lot of denial, and ridiculing the subject and making it sound like it's crazy, even though it has been part of humanity's history for thousands of years, like thousands of years of recorded history. These events, these sightings, these experiences have been recorded. And those documents are still available. And those belief systems are still there. So I find it interesting now with the news. One of my concerns is that this information is going to come out, because along with anything, any kind of new piece of technology, any kind of new anything that arises, usually what happens and what humans do, what humans have done, history shows, is that they take things and they figure out how to weaponize them. They figure out how to be destructive with new information, new discoveries, new technology. Immediately, militaries want to weaponize and create destruction, you know, the ability to destroy. So the concern is, you know, okay, this information, at least with recent modern history, has been shoved aside. It's been denied. It's been ridiculed. It's sort of made to look like kind of a tabloid thing. And unfortunately, there are people that are trying to make money, and they'll make up things and it makes it sound really ridiculous. And then there's information to try to discredit the whole subject. So there are a lot of things that are involved in the issue with extraterrestrials and UFOs, and the new acronym is UAP, right? UFO, UAP, and Unidentified Aerial Phenomenon. So now I feel like it seems like there's a little more, at least as of right now, it sounds kind of neutral. where it's like, yeah, these are craft. There's a video recently. Let me pull it up. And it was from, let's see, this video in particular is from 2020, April 28th, 2020. So just a little over a year ago. Declassification of videos, clear up any misconceptions by the public, whether or not the footage that has been circulating is real. The Pentagon said in a statement Monday, the footage, which shows unidentified objects flying at high speeds in the Earth's atmosphere, along with audio of Navy pilots expressing shock and awe, was initially leaked in 2007 and 2017. U.S. Navy formalized a reporting process last year for pilots to report incidents of UFO sightings. The Department of Defense released three videos taken by U.S. Navy pilots revealing mysterious flying objects that to this day remain unidentified. Okay, this is CNBC. I'm going to link the video in the description box of this video. It says a declassification of the videos late Monday, one of which was taken in 2004, and the subsequent two taken in 2015 was meant to clear up any misconceptions by the public on whether or not the footage that has been circulating was real or whether or not there is more to the videos, the Pentagon said in a statement Monday. The footage, which shows unidentified objects flying at high speeds in the Earth's atmosphere. Okay, so this is kind of like repeating. I know it's repeating itself, but okay, anyway, Earth's atmosphere, along with audio of Navy pilots expressing shock and awe, was initially leaked in 2007 and 2017. The videos were taken during training flights, and the 2017 leaks were published by the New York Times. The U.S. Navy previously acknowledged that these videos circulating in the public domain were indeed Navy videos. So they are actual Navy videos. The Pentagon statement read, after a thorough review, the department has determined that the authorized release of these unclassified videos does not reveal any sensitive capabilities or systems and does not impinge on any subsequent investigations of military airspace incursions by unidentified aerial phenomena, which is the UAP. The aerial phenomena observed in the videos remain characterized as unidentified, it said. So, the Navy has stated, let's see, the Pentagon is saying that these videos are, in fact, Navy videos, that they were taken. There's the aerial, there's actual video footage of the objects. They are actual objects. They are flying at really high rates of speed. Their maneuvers and stuff are beyond our understanding. And the Navy pilots are heard in the video talking about them. Those were actual Navy pilots, and that's actual video from the U.S. Navy. And the Pentagon has stated that those videos are in fact real and that the objects in those videos remain unidentified. So, okay, so there's that, right? And the thing is with this technology, and I've looked at different things. I particularly like information, films, and footage, interviews and so on from the filmmaker James Fox and also from Stephen Greer. They have really good stuff on military and commercial pilots from all over the world, all sorts of different military personnel. The Rendlesham Forest incident, they have interviewed people. They go into detail. There are a lot there's a lot of detail and a lot of sources of information that are reporting these kinds of things. And so I like to look at their stuff in particular. And the thing is that these objects move at impossibly high speeds. They're able to move impossibly fast. And you know, looking through footage and eyewitnesses, civilians, military, and so on, and they tend to describe really similar things. There's a lot in common with the reports, and it's that they zip around in these impossible speeds, and there's no like sonic boom heard because at this rate of speed that a physical object is, the way that they move, it would create, you know, sonic booms. It would break the sound barrier, and it doesn't happen. And then they're able to instantly stop. They're able to make right turns. They're able to disappear and appear. And that level of technology You know, they have clearly our mathematics and our physics, we don't understand. We don't understand how it is that they could do that. And one of the things that's quite compelling that I've heard in some of this, these document, you know, interviews and so on, is that, you know, if it was human and had that been developed by humans, some of that technology along the way to getting to level 10,000 would have leaked. It would have been used. There would be other uses, and some of that some of that technology would have leaked out into the public and became part of overall technological advancement. And we would have been able to see how some of it already exists in the culmination and ultimately those kinds of technological abilities. But we don't. We don't see that. What we have is what we have at level one, as I'm saying, for example, and they're at level 10,000 or beyond. And there's nothing in between to kind of link it to say, oh, well, you know, we had some of this technology and some of that technology and some of this. And yeah, we were headed in that direction. Some of it would have become declassified. Some of it would have started having like regular public use. And again, it hasn't. So that is a strong indication that those that are maneuvering, that are managing, that have that technology are not human. So that's really interesting. I love the topic. I've been following it for years. It's absolutely fascinating to me. I will link a couple of the videos. There's one where this is, again, from a year ago. And then I have this video. Here is an interview with a retired Navy commander on the unidentified flying object he saw flying in the sky during a training mission in 2004. So Commander David Fravor on the unidentified object he saw flying in the sky during a training mission in 2004. And this is from NBC News. And this interview was from April 15th, 2021. So I'm noticing like this information, like it came, that video came out like a year ago, like officially on big sites. And then I noticed like there's more information about it. There's more talk about it, which I find interesting. My concern is that the military, the war profiteers are going to try to find a way to try to profit from this information. Like, okay, well, if it's going to come out in the public, you know, the war profiteers are going to try to find a way to continue to make money, because unfortunately we have a business on planet Earth that is called war, and that's actually a gigantic business. There's profit from it. And they're going to try to find ways to convince the public into weaponizing, building weapons in space or whatever. I think at this point, humans are pretty fed up with war and waging war against other countries. And I think we're at a breaking point right now. And I think if the war profiteers, the military, whatever, they want to push more ideas of war, it's going to be really hard for them to try to sell it to us. So what are they going to do next? So hopefully they will not try to weaponize space. It sounds like there's kind of a little Space Force type thing happening. I hope the public doesn't buy it. I don't think we can even do anything close to what these UAPs, UFOs have, their technology and their abilities. And, you know, wanting to weaponize space, I think, would just be another scam, another war scam, to scam the public of trillions of dollars worth of taxpayer dollars. I know for sure from what I've seen, the threat to humans is human. Humans are a threat to human beings. And we look at the way things are structured right now. You know, like the world makes enough food to feed everyone. Like everyone should be able to eat every day. We have enough food for that. But because we see it as profit, it's controlled by profit. You know, food is thrown away. And, you know, just different things like that. And humans are not friendly to humans. Humans are a threat to humans. We come up with technology and immediately it becomes weaponized. Immediately there are ways to figure out how to make bigger bombs, how to create more dangerous things. So from what I see, the problem is human. The threat is human. From what I understand, interviews and stuff that I've heard in regards to unidentified aerial phenomenon, what appears to be extraterrestrial aircraft. The Rendlesham Forest incident, it was a military base that had in the UK, US military base in the UK that had nuclear warheads on it. So there were nuclear weapons on that base. And one of these craft came down and there were military personnel that saw it and actually went toward it. And they had their audio recording on, and there's, you can have access to that information. Stephen Greer has that information. And I believe James Fox does also, with interviews and so on, where he interviews the people that actually witnessed it. And so anyway, what happens is, you know, they visit these military bases that have nuclear weapons on them. And what they're able to do is they're able to disable the controls. They're able to shut them off so that weapons aren't launched. They also seem to be surveying, because a vehicle in Rendlesham Forest, one of the military personnel had I'm sure he's going through his training, and someone has audio on. I don't know which one of them had it recording, and they were talking about what they were seeing and the lights and all that and craft. And one of them actually went over and touched the craft and looked and was walking around the craft and had a notepad and was writing what it is he was experiencing. And sounds like something he was acting on his training. He's trained to do that, and that's what he was doing. And he said that he saw some symbols, and he drew out the symbols, and there were other things that happened. So in a James Fox film, he is interviewed, and he's talking about that, and he shows his little notepad and how he drew stuff. So then James Fox took those symbols to a mathematician. He was saying, well, you know, if there's a universal language, it would be mathematics. And he took it to a mathematician, and a mathematician was just speculating. But the mathematician said, okay, looking at these, you know, symbols, like, what is it that they would mean? And I know a set of the symbols, described certain mathematics, mathematical principles. And then he said, you know, that what this looks like is that it's like, what it's saying, or what the craft was likely a surveying vehicle. Again, he was speculating, but still, some sort of surveying vehicle. So it sounds like there are surveying vehicles, as well, or I don't know, they go around and check what's going on and keep eyes on things. And they happen to be seen quite frequently where military weaponry is around. So, and then there are reports as well of military, you know, pilots and stuff and bases and everything, where they try to do something and or they see that their controls get shut down. You know, there was one pilot, an Iranian pilot, and he saw a craft and while he was flying, and he said, well, if it gets closer, you know, that he's going to shoot. And, you know, he's trying to figure out what to do, right, according to his training. Turns out that his controls, his weaponry controls, were disabled. And they just stopped working and just like shut off. And he was like, oh, my goodness. And then the craft took off, and then they turned back on again. So they have not just the maneuverability, but they have the ability to shut things down, you know, if they deem necessary. Stephen Greer is really interesting because he goes into, you know, all that stuff, but he also likes to focus on, well, who is in those vehicles, or like who built them, you know, whether if they're surveying vehicles and no one's inside, or if they're vehicles with beings inside, who are those beings and how to approach that. So that's really interesting. Stephen Greer has hours and hours of stuff. He's got like really long videos with workshops and stuff that he does on like consciousness and meditation, and also energy systems, like energy technology and extraterrestrials and so on. And James Fox does a lot of really good stuff too, and has a lot of really good sources that he presents, and he's got a really good style of presenting as well. So I'll link the stuff that is like for free that I can find on YouTube, and then the trailers to the other stuff, just, you know, if anyone wants to look into it. And then the news reports, like this stuff here, the interview with the pilot and the footage of the aircraft. Yeah, quite fascinating. I will put links of all that stuff in the description box of this video, so you can check that out if you want. And then the document, the CIA document, I haven't looked at it in a while, but I've read it. And it talks about astral projection. It goes in and talks about stuff like transcendental meditation. It talks about different things that can induce auto body. And it goes through and let's see, CIA astral projection document, PDF, CIA website, www.cia.gov. It's the actual website of the CIA. And astral projection, let's see, subject, printer friendly version. Let's see, I just kind of want to look at the document. Subject volunteer to attempt to locate facility in the... Oh, this is another document. Declassified. Released 2011. Hold on. Telephone call from subject to me from second. Oh, this is actually a different document. I'm going to have to go through this one. I will link it in the description box also. I mean, telephone call from subject volunteer to attempt to locate a facility in the USSR comparable to the underground installation previously described, found it, gave it its exact coordinates. Okay, so I'm going to check that one out. Let me open up a new link. I'm going to leave that there. I'm going to go to Google. I'm going to see if I can pull up this document that I'm talking about. And they researched like Robert Monroe, and he wrote books on out of body, and he developed a system and like the hemi-sync system and so on. And so the CIA looked into it. CIA document, astral projection. I'm going to maybe write hemi-sync. Maybe that'll pull it up. 25 gateway. Oh yeah. CIA's gateway report on astral projection. Okay, but this isn't the CIA. And oh, here it is right here. This is directly from the CIA. Pulling up, it's a PDF file. And it is, oh, it's the Department of the Army. So released for approval 2003, U.S. Army Operational Group, U.S. Army Intelligence and Security Command, Fort George C. Meade, Maryland, 20755. Subject, analysis and assessment of the gateway process. I don't know if I'm going to do another video on it. I mean, person can go through and read it. It's very technical. A person basically did a report and they went into various different things involving astral projection, the experience of astral projection. I feel that compared to other information, like they were like, oh, the highest level, you know, that's in this report. And there's a whole lot more that can be done with astral projection. And there were many more levels of it that are not included in this document. But nonetheless, it's pretty interesting to see, you know, like the background information, intro, they talk about hypnosis, see transcendental meditation, they have basically diagrams of the brain labeled, and there's a lot of really good information. They talk about Kundalini rising, let's see, biofeedback, gateway and hemi-sync. And these systems are connected to hemi-sync Robert Monroe, again, who wrote books on astral projecting and astral projection. And lamp versus laser, frequency following response, role of resonance. So it's very technical, brain stimulation, energy entrainment, consciousness and energy. And so on. It just keeps going. And again, it's very, very technical approach to it. They're trying to really just map out and show what is it, you know, what are different levels of it? What is it that people experience in regards to cognition, energy, time-space dimension, intervening dimensions, subatomic particles, and then it goes into... out-of-body experiences. I'm just kind of reading some of the titles. It's quite interesting. Anyway, so this was back. I did read this. And then there's also someone, more than one person on YouTube, that reads it out loud. So you could get an audio version of it. If you search for it on YouTube, you could get that too. But anyway, it's interesting to see like what it is they researched and what it is they found and the different things that connect to things like astral projection and like, what is it, how can it be used? They also did stuff with remote viewing. remote viewing, and they had people like Ingo Swann and several other people, and this was at Stanford. And Ingo Swann was already psychic, and he was, you know, they were trying to see, like, can you look at, like, military, you know, bases or in whatever in other countries and stuff. And so they did research there, and that's really good information. Like, if you look up Ingo Swann and remote viewing and stuff like that. So anyway, that's another system, another process, I guess, of tapping into, like, second sight, right? Ingo Swann had the additional already, like, psychic abilities. Meditation is mentioned a lot, and that's because meditation causes the development of psychic abilities and lucid dreaming, as well as astral projection, which are oftentimes the same, lucid dreaming and astral projection. So here's the document. It's several pages long, and I'm going to link it in the description box for anyone that's interested, just to kind of see a technical analysis and kind of just how sort of technical military personnel approached it, researched it, and is describing it. So that's that. The other document, I'm going to look through it and see, like, what was that? It looks like it was something regarding astral projection. There might be more articles on it, even beyond those that I just mentioned, in regards to astral projection that I don't know about. But I'm going to link the one that I read, and then where'd the other one go? Oh, here it is. Astral Projection Keeper. What? Telephone call from the subject volunteers attempt. Looks like astral projection. Well, it's astral projection in the title. And it is a document that used to be top secret, but it was declassified in 2011. What department is this? Like, what branch of military? I don't know. Anyway, I haven't read through this one, but this is on the CIA.gov site. So I'll link it in the description box and just kind of see what that's about. Looks like they had to block some stuff out, but still, there's plenty of content there. Something I'll probably read later. Okay, anyway, I don't know. I just want to talk about that stuff. Came across the interview of the pilot today and just thought, wow, you know, more talk about UFOs, more talk about things that were denied for a long time. How's this going to come out? Like, is this going to now be something that modern society talks about? And how is it going to be integrated? How are we going to deal with the problem with things always being militarized, weaponized, constantly seeing things as threats? And, you know, because I really think it's really clear that humans are the threat to humans. That's really, really clear. That the way the systems that we've set up is humans are harmful to humans. So aliens, extraterrestrials, UFOs, UAPs are zipping around. They can shut off military controls on bases that have nuclear warheads, and they defy physics completely as we know it, and they are so far advanced beyond anything even coming close to our most technological tech, and there is no leak in between that level of technology and the level of technology we have now. There's nothing in between that has been leaked, so it's a strong indication that it's not human, does not come from humans. And the whole idea of trying to weaponize space and build space-based weapons, to me, sounds like just another business pitch from the war profiteers, from the big business known as war, to funnel trillions of taxpayer dollars, continue to you know, just this rebranding way of scaring people into funneling money to build weapons in space. And I don't think that they would do anything. Because if UAPs, UFOs, extraterrestrials, are advanced as they appear to be, and that appears to be the case, our space-based weapons would be useless in the face of them. And if they wanted to do harm, they absolutely could. So far, humans have been doing a lot of harm, you know, and I get a little, you know, I don't want to talk too much about people wanting to point the finger all the time at scary beings that aren't human and how evil they are. Let's point the finger at human beings, because we know for sure human beings are causing harm on this planet, not just environmental harm to nature itself, like the water and the land and, you know, oceans and rivers and, you know, underground and what we put in the air, but direct harm to human beings. So let's point the finger where we know we can point the finger, where we know there's a problem, and trying to divert that and say, oh, evil influences. Oh, it must be something outside of the non-human. Well, okay, but my focus is that there humans are 100% capable of being as evil as they are. And it's human. It's human nature. It's human, human errors, human problems of greed and, you know, violence and, you know, just these destructive tendencies that we have as human beings, as humanity. And that's really where the problem needs to be. So if this information starts coming out and then this whole pointing the finger at UAPs as being the problem and how we need to protect ourselves against them, I will not buy it at all. There's no way that humans, the military industrial complex, is going to get away after everything that they've done to the world, to the planet, to people, that they're going to try to shift the blame to UFOs that have been around for thousands and thousands of years. And we have documented ancient records to document they've been around for thousands of years. So, and where's the problem they've caused? Where have they caused a problem, you know? And I know there's a lot of stuff in the UFO world, you know, people saying that, I don't know. Anytime it's fear-based and people are afraid and they want to make a big issue out of it, I'm just like, you know, we've got the elephant in the room, which is human beings, human violence and greed. That 100% sure we know is a massive problem on Earth. Let's point the finger there and figure out how to stop this, how to call it out, how to try to understand it, and what systems we can put into place to prevent things like corruption, prevent things like violence, and so on. We have human beings that are blowing up cities with families in them, and they just blow these cities up. This has happened in history. We've had decades of war, even the most recent decades. It's just constant war. Anyway, just saying, you know, I know there's a lot of movies out there that love to demonize, you know, extraterrestrials, and they try to make the military look like the saviors or whatever. It's just like, just sounds not reality. Anyway, links are in the description box, and I think I'm done kind of just talking about it right now. All right.